In this lecture, I am going to talk about nonlinear distortion. In the previous lecture, we discussed linear distortion, namely amplitude distortion and then phase distortion. Okay, so when I said linear, there is also other types of distortion called nonlinear distortion. And as the name implies, this kind of distortion would arise in a communication system in which some part of the communication system or the other. Okay, so now let us think about some kind of non-linearities which can cope up in the communication system. Now we should ask ourselves that what are the components which can give rise to some non-linearity. Okay, mainly the amplifier is a good example for a non-linear device. Okay, so particularly power amplifiers. Okay, not the voltage or a current amplifiers, but power amplifiers. Okay, I think you might have done some course on power amplification. Okay, some discussion on power amplification, class B amplifier and class C amplifier. These are all, you know, power amplifiers. Let us take one of these power amplifiers. Okay, so whatever knowledge you have is sufficient for discussion. Okay, now one can ask, under what condition do they work most efficiently, or under what conditions these amplifiers will work very well. Okay, so they work very well if your amplitude in the input signal remains constant. If the amplitude fluctuates a lot, first of all, they do not work very efficiently. So as long as the amplifier is in the linear region, then no problem. The moment it crosses the linear region, then it introduces some kind of non-linearity. Okay, so we are more concerned about the fact that the amplifier gives different amounts of amplification depending on the amplitude of the input signal. Okay, so for certain amplitude of the input signal, it gives a certain amount of gain, and for certain other amplitude of the input signal, it gives some other value of gain. So it treats, you know, the low amplitude signal in some way and higher amplitude signals in some other way. So this is, you know, not a good thing. Okay, so because of this treatment, we have some kind of effect called non-linearity. Linear means it should treat all the frequency all the amplitudes equally. Okay, let's say this is Vi. Either you give 1 millivolt or 2 millivolt, 3 millivolt, it should, let's say the slope is 10. Okay, so it should give 10 millivolt output or 20 millivolts output, like that. Let's say 30 millivolts. This is output. So this is the linear amplifier characteristics, but in practical this will not happen. Okay, so there will be some kind of curve like this. So then what happens? For lower amplitude input signal, it amplifies properly. For a higher amplitude input signals, it will not amplify, you know, differently. So this is unacceptable thing. Therefore, this non-linearity arises due to non-linear transfer characteristics of amplifiers. Okay, so this is called transfer characteristics. don't confuse with a transfer function and a transfer characteristics. So the important point to note down is non-linearity arises due to non-linear transfer characteristics. Of amplifiers and mixers. We will discuss mixers as we go along. Okay, so please note that what I am writing here. Okay, I said transfer characteristics. It is not a non-linear transfer function, it is transfer characteristics. Because for non-linear systems, you cannot study in terms of transfer function. In fact, you cannot derive or you cannot find out the transfer function for a non-linear system. So here we are not talking about a frequency domain here. Okay, in frequency domain only transfer function exists, right? So you take the Laplace transform or Fourier transform and take the ratio of the Laplace transform of output divided by the Laplace transform of the input, like y of s divided by x of s or y of j omega divided by x of j omega. This is your transfer function. So here we are not talking in terms of frequency domain. So I am saying here due to non-linear characteristics. So this is input output characteristics of a non-linear device. Input output characteristics of non-linear device. The best example is your power amplifier. Okay, so we are studying about amplifiers and mixers. When I talk about a receiver, that time I will say something about more about mixers. So these are the devices which can exhibit non-linearity. We still have to talk about mixers, but I will talk about them a little later, as I said. Okay, now let us talk about amplifiers, especially power amplifiers. So when I say transfer characteristics of an amplifier, how does the plot look? Already I have drawn this one here. Plot. Still, let me draw it very clearly. So, this is your input. Let's say the input signal is x of t. You have a power amplifier or simply amplifier, and the input signal is x of t. Output signal, it is denoted by y of t. And this is output. Okay, so when I say transfer characteristics, I'm plotting the relation between input and output. Okay, so simply plot output versus input like this. Let's say the slope is 10 times it amplifies. So we are here referring to the amplitude of output versus the amplitude of the input. So this is the output amplitude and here input amplitude. So the transfer characteristics of an ideal amplifier looks like this. So it doesn't matter what the range of input signal amplitude is, either you give 1 millivolt or 2 millivolts or 100 millivolts, doesn't time, it amplifies the corresponding ratio. Let's say this is 10 times 100 thousand millivolts. So like that it amplifies. Just an example, I am taking 1 millivolt, 2 millivolt, not necessarily it should be 1 millivolt or 2 millivolt and so on and so forth. Okay. So it is a straight line. For ideal amplifier, the transfer characteristics should be straight line. But in practice, it will not be a straight line. Okay. So if the transfer characteristics is straight line, what does it mean? If input is small, output should be small. Correspondingly, if the input is large, the corresponding output should be large. Very simple, nothing beyond that. So the output is a constant times the input. Y of t is equal to, let's say, some constant k times the input x of t. Okay, so ideally the output y of t, this is output, should be equal to some constant k times the input x of t, where k is the amplification factor. Either it amplifies 10 times or 100 times or 50 times, it depends on the amplifier design. Amplification factor. Now, practical power amplifiers will exhibit a kind of non-linearity. Okay. So, if you take a practical power amplifier, then you may not have this linear characteristics. Okay. You don't get a straight line between the output and the input. So, which is very common, in practical power amplifiers, you will get some kind of non-linearity, and this non-linearity is very commonly encountered in power amplifiers, and this is called saturation non-linearity. The saturation non-linearity basically arises because you have some finite value of the power supplies. Okay, you cannot produce output indefinitely. Because of this, as your input signal becomes larger and larger in amplitude, instead of being linear, as I said, like this, it is going to slightly saturate like this. It becomes a horizontal line, and here also it becomes horizontal line. So as per the theory, if say 1 millivolt, the output should be 1, let's say 10 millivolts, and if it is 100 millivolt, then output should be, let's say, 1000 millivolt if the slope is 10. But here the slope is not 10, right? It is almost saturated. Now what happens here? Let's say the input is 1000 millivolt, then it should be 10,000 millivolt I am supposed to get, but I may get around 1050 millivolts. So for higher amplitude input signals, my amplifier is not amplifying by 10 times. So because of that, the non-linearity comes into the picture. So this portion is called a saturation mode. Okay. So as your input signal becomes larger in this region, larger and larger in amplitude, instead of being linear like this, it becomes like this, saturated, and you get into this non-linear or saturation mode. This is called non-linear or saturation mode. The amplifier enters into non-linear region. It does not remain linear for all values of the input amplitudes. Of course, the amplifier is linear for lower amplitude region. See, in this region it is linear. The moment you cross this point, then it becomes non-linear. That's what I am trying to say. So as long as your input signal is within the linear range, then you are fine. Your amplifier is perfectly good, no problem. But if your input signal goes beyond the linear range, say this is a linear range, right? Linear range, then the output is no longer proportional to the input x of t. So in this non-linear region, your y of t is no longer a constant times x of t. Okay, so this is not applicable in non-linear region. So this is applicable only in the linear region, k times x of t. Here it is equal and here it is not equal. Okay, so in the non-linear region, y of t is no longer k times x of t. So that is called the non-linearity. So this condition is called a non-linearity. Now basically, if you want to model this non-linearity, like this. So non-linearity, you can see that you cannot model it as a straight line. See, if it is a straight line, no problem. You can write like y of t is equal to the slope of the signal k times x of t, like that you can, you know, model it. But it is no longer straight line after this, you know, point, especially after this point towards the right side, it is no longer a straight line. Okay, so you don't have a straight line kind of relationship, that is linear kind of relationship of this kind, like this. So you have to introduce some model. Okay, like you should come up with a mathematical model or mathematical equation which describes this non-linearity. This curve, it is a curve up to this portion, no problem, it is like a linear region. Okay, so there are, you know, well developed theories which are available to model this such kind of, you know, non-linearity. Okay, so that is called a parametric model. Parametric model, for example, we can possibly model it as a polynomial of some kind. Okay, you write down some polynomial of some kind so that it closely, you know, models this curve. Okay, such that the resulting curve would be looks like the characteristics of the amplifier. That is the usual thing, okay, that is done to model non-linear components and non-linear devices. Okay, so a polynomial model is used to model the non-linear components and non-linear devices. Even if you recall from your diodes and transistors, there also we use parametric model. Okay, because the input and output characteristics of the diode is not linear, it is a curve like this. Okay, so this is your voltage across a diode and this is a current which is flowing through the diode. So again, the curve is not linear, it is like some non-linear curve, and this also modeled with a polynomial equation, a polynomial model. So this polynomial model is used to model not only amplifiers but also non-linear components and other non-linear devices. So the typical model is given below. Okay, and this model captures the non-linear things. Okay, so let's say y of t is equal to, say, let's a times x of t. Now this one captures linear region, it's a linear relationship, right? Linear region. Okay, this would have, this is a condition for ideal amplifier. So this is a thing for this is the one which we want for ideal thing. But you also have additional terms because of this non-linearity. So a times x of t plus the additional terms are like a2 times x squared of t, okay, plus a3 times x cube of 3, and so on and so forth. So this is the typical polynomial model for a non-linear device or non-linear components. And theoretically, it is possible to find a set of coefficients. This, let me call this as a1, a2, a3. So these are called something called a curve fitting. Okay, so you can find out these values a1, a2, a3, etc. with a polynomial of some suitable degree. Either you want to go up to x cube of 3 or x to the 4 of 3 or and so on. It depends on the shape of your curve. Okay, such that this resulting characteristics resemble the actual curve that we plotted, like x versus y. It goes like this. Suppose let's take a very simple non-linearity case, simple analysis, just for the sake of understanding. I am not going to consider x cube of t or x to the 4 of t. Okay, I am going to take a very simple case. My device is very simple now. Let us take a 1 times x of t plus a 2 times x squared of t. One thing is clear in this, that the output is not a replica of x of t, right? Suppose if this guy is not there, then this output is just replica of the input. So whatever the input you are giving, that is amplified by an amount of a1. Now the moment you add the second term, like y of t is equal to a1 times x of t plus a2 times x squared of t, then it is no longer the output is no longer the replica of the input. That is for sure. Okay. In normal case, what we wanted is, we would like to have the output, we would like the output to be simply proportional to x of t, but if we have additional component, this x squared of t. Okay. So therefore, there is a kind of distortion here. Okay. But how does this distortion differ from the linear distortion? See, this I called non-linear distortion. Now one can ask a question, how does this non-linear distortion differ from linear distortion? That is a very important point that we should understand. This non-linear distortion is very, very unavoidable thing and unwanted thing and very irritating thing in communication system than linear distortion. So we should know the difference between linear distortion and non-linear distortion. Okay. If you remember, I had made a comment in the last lecture. Okay, so when we talked about linear distortions, that linear distortion which arises due to non-ideal characteristics of the channel. Okay, in terms of its transfer function, if you recall, then your channel transfer function HC of F is not equal to K times e to the minus j omega t d. So, non-ideal characteristics of the channel. That means what? The channel can only do something good or something bad relatively to different frequency components that exist in the message signal. The channel, at the most, what the channel can do in linear distortion, it can offer different attenuation for different frequency components, and it can offer a different delay for different frequency components. That's what at the max it can do. Okay. So the channel can do something good or something bad relatively to the different frequency components which exist in the channel, which exist in the message signal. But it cannot create additional frequency components. Okay, but so that is an important point. In linear distortion, it will not create any additional or new frequency component. But on the other hand, non-linear distortion creates additional distortion, additional or new frequency component. That is very, very bad. No, it is very good for some other applications, but at least for amplification purpose, it is very bad. Okay, for mixers and other applications, for frequency multipliers, there we need this non-linear distortion. That is we want actually. As I said, one man's food is poison for the others. Therefore, a linear filter essentially affects whatever frequency components are present in the message signal. Okay, it is simply affect the message signal. It cannot produce new frequency components. Okay, so it will amplify them differently or attenuate them differently. It will delay them differently. Okay, one frequency component gets more delay than the other frequency component. That's all. That's all it can do. That is the linear distortion. But non-linear distortion, on the other hand, has a potential to generate a new frequency. Okay, generate a frequency component in the output message signal, which were not even present in the input signal. See, in the input signal, it has some frequency component. Let's say F1, F2, let's say F5. F3, F4, F5 like this, but in the output it may contain some extra frequencies. Okay, so that is a very, very important way in which non-linear distortion differs from the linear distortion. So whenever we say non-linear distortion, it produces additional frequency component, and those frequency components not even present in the original input message signal. It is producing something new which is not there in your original message. Okay, now let me give an example. Suppose the input signal is a pure sine wave, just for the sake of appreciating this point, just for the sake of understanding. Anyway, we will not send a pure sine wave, we will not transmit. What is the need to transmit a sine wave? After all, sine wave can be generated wherever you want, right? So what is the purpose of transmitting sine wave? Sine wave is after all a carrier, that's it. It is not a message signal. Now, for understanding purpose, let us take a sine wave, how this non-linearity will affect the signal and how the new frequency components are produced. Let's say a pure sine wave with the frequency F1. X of t is equal to sine of 2 pi f1t. Now your output is y of t is equal to, let's say, 2 times sine of, I'm sorry, 2 times x of t plus 1 times x squared of t, and so on. Let me stop up to this point. Now your output contains not only sine 2 pi f1t, but it also contains square of sine 2 pi f1t. So 2 times sine 2 pi f1t plus sine squared of 2 pi f1t. Now what is the frequency component in this term? F1. And what is the frequency component in this term? It is sine square theta. Okay, so sine square theta equal to 1 minus cos 2 theta by 2. Therefore, 1 minus cos 2 theta means 2 times f, 2 times 4 pi f1t whole divided by 2. Therefore, 1 minus cos of 2 pi times 2 f1 times t. I can write like this, right? Whole divided by 2. Now, what is the frequency component present in this? 2 times f1. See, originally your input contains only f1, but in the output, it contains F1 in addition plus another component F2 also. So new frequency, sorry, 2 F1, 2 times of the frequency which you sent. Okay, so originally the sine 2 pi F1 contains the frequency F1, but the sine square of 2 pi F1t, it can be written as 1 minus cos 2 theta, so 1 minus cos 4 pi f 1t divided by 2. So in this one, additional frequency component 2 f1 is present. Okay, so 2 f1 was not present in the input message signal. This is the input message signal. Okay, it contains only f1. So this is a very simple situation. Okay, so the input contains F1 and the output contains F1 comma 2 F1. Suppose now the input signal contains two components, let's say F1 and F2. Let's say two frequency component, sine of 2π f1t plus sine of, let me take cos, no problem, cos of 2π f1t plus cos of 2π f2t. This is a frequency component present in the input signal. So your input contains two frequency components, f1 and f2. Now what will you have? Now we will obviously have, like, let's say y of t equal to 2 times x of t plus x squared of t. So the first component is not a problem, this one is not a problem, it's a linear amplification. 2 times cos of 2π f1t plus 2 times cos of 2π f2t plus cos of 2π f1t plus cos of 2π f2t whole squared. Now you expand this a plus b the whole square formula, then this one no problem, f1 and f2 no issues. If you expand this, cos squared of 2π f1t plus b square cos squared of 2π f2t plus 2ab, 2 times cos of 2π f1t multiplied by cos of 2π f2t. Now there is a square term, so this guy gives 2 times f1, and there is a square term here also, this guy gives 2 times f2, and here multiplication of, you know, cos 2π f1t and cos 2π f2t, cos a cos b, okay, and again expand that cos a cos b equal to like cos of a plus b plus cos of a minus b. So therefore it contains, if you expand this using trigonometric identity, then you have f1 plus f2 comma f1 minus f2, or you can write f2 minus f1, no problem, after all it is a cosine term, okay. So in the output I have f1 f2 2 f1 2 f2 f1 plus f2 f1 minus f2. See, these are all additional components, 2f1 2f2 f1 minus f2 f1 plus f2, these are all additional components. So your input x of t contains only two frequency components, f1 and f2, but your output y of t contains f1 f2 2f1 2f2 f1 plus f2 comma f and f1 minus f2, or simply you can write this guy as f1 plus or minus f2. So it is a matter of just writing down the trigonometry and seeing that you will get these terms, okay. So this additional frequency component, this one and this one, that are getting generated is a real problem in non-linear distortions. These components we call intermodulation components. Okay, and for this reason this is also called a harmonic distortion, because harmonic distortion is nothing but it is a integer multiple of the fundamental frequency. If you have f1, then you'll get 2 times f1, 3 times f1, 4 times f1, so these are called harmonic distortion or intermodulation distortion. These are different terminologies that generally people will call. Because different frequency components modulate with each other, to produce additional frequency component. So these are all additional frequency components. Okay, so we can call it either harmonic distortion or intermodulation distortion. Now one can ask a question, is intermodulation good or is intermodulation bad? See, that is very bad for our purpose here. Why is it bad? Because you are producing additional frequency component. See, there are, it is bad due to two reasons. First one is power. Okay, so power is an issue. See, if y of t equal to k times x of t, then what happens? Whatever the power, that power is now gone to x of t. But if you have additional terms, like let me write now, a times x of t, then no issues. All the power will contain in this signal only, which is what we want. But you have a 2 times x squared of t. This term we don't want at all, but again you are investing some amount of power in this. So it is a waste of power, right? Anyway, we don't want this component. In fact, you can filter out this component also, no problem. You can put a filter, appropriate filter, and you can remove it. But again, you are unnecessarily wasting the power. Okay, it is creating component outside of the bandwidth B. Suppose you have a signal of bandwidth B. Your distorted signal will have components much beyond B. Okay, so for that component also you are giving some amount of power, no? Your amplifier is amplifying and giving some amount of power for that frequency component also. So in that case you are wasting the power. So obviously you are going to speak into somebody else bandwidth. Suppose let's say up to B is given to user 1 and B to 2B is given to user 2. And 2B to 3B given to user 3. Then what happens? Because of this intermodulation due to non-linearity, you may produce some frequency component which lie in this band, your neighbor bandwidth. So your frequency component will go and interfere that guy. So let's say this is your frequency F1, then if you produce 2F1 will sit somewhere else here. And F1 minus, let's say this point is F2, let me enlarge this. Let's say this is F2. Now F1 minus F2 also will sit somewhere else. So F1 minus F2 is a problem for yourself and 2F1 is the problem for somebody else. 2F2 is a problem for somebody else. And F1 minus F2 is a problem for yourself. So anyway, either for you or other, the intermodulation is the biggest headache. Okay, so you are allotted a certain frequency band to work with, but you are transmitting outside the band to your neighbor. So therefore your received signal contains components outside the band. So that is the thing that we don't want. So if your receiver was now trying to look at for a signal in that frequency band, they will not only see that your signal, but also see some components from this. This will cause a kind of crosstalk. Okay, it is called a co-channel interference. Let's say this is 0 to B. Let's call channel 1. And B to 2B, call channel 2. Or let me write down here. Channel 1. And this one is channel 2, channel 3, and so on and so forth. Therefore, you are creating a crosstalk to the other channel, or somebody else is creating a crosstalk to you. Therefore, it is called co-channel interference, sometimes also simply called a crosstalk. So, this is not a good thing. Now F1 plus F2 is much higher than the bandwidth of, let's say this is 0 and this is B, and let's say f1 is here and f2 is here. F1 plus f2 will sit somewhere else, let's say f1 plus f2 here. Then this f1 plus f2, you can filter, actually put a filter, either band pass filter or low pass filter or whatever it is, you can filter this out. But this frequency, what happens, it is there in the air or in the channel, okay? So this frequency will be received by another channel or will be received by the another user. So will that create a problem? Therefore, the point is, you are definitely going to create a distortion for yourself, that is obviously happening. So within the frequency band, you have some frequency components. So you are generating additional frequency component. These additional frequency components may lie within the bandwidth of interest, or they may lie outside the bandwidth of interest here in this bandwidth. So they will typically have both kind of situations. See, f1 minus f2 may be somewhere here. So that is a problem for you. So f1 minus f2 will typically lie within the bandwidth of interest, that is 0 to B. And f1 plus f2 will lie outside the bandwidth of interest here. Okay, so both kinds of things are bad. F1 minus F2 also bad. F1 plus F2 is bad. F1 minus F2 is bad for you. F1 plus F2 is bad for somebody else. Okay, so F1 plus F2 creates distortion for somebody else, or crosstalk for somebody else. Okay, and F1 minus F2 creates distortion for you. You don't have F1 minus F2 originally, but you are creating something new, so that will completely collapses your information, your signal. So one has to be very, very careful when we are using this non-linearity. So the non-linear distortion is, you know, different from your linear distortion. So the main difference is, your linear distortion will not generate any new frequency component. After all, it can attenuate differently for a different frequency component and delay differently for a different frequency component. That's all it can do. On the other hand, your non-linear distortion will create additional frequency, will generate additional frequency, and this additional frequencies are bad for you and bad for others. Okay, so let me stop at this point. Thank you very much.